All right, let me now show you how we can implement residual networks in PyTorch. So I will show you two notebooks. First is a naive implementation I made myself, and then I will show you a more sophisticated implementation of ResNet 34 from the PyTorch community. So in this first notebook now, I will show you what we talked about in the last video, these two different types of residual blocks. And then in the next notebook, I will show you this residual network with 34 layers. So I'm not going to rerun this notebook. It didn't take too long, but why waiting if it's not necessary? So I will show you just the results. So here it's just a boilerplate importing Torch and NumPy, the usual stuff for the data set. So I'm not using the helper functions here because it's really just very simple. So I didn't really focus on abstracting things. I just coded the residual blocks, and this is a self-contained notebook in that way. So here I'm using the MNIST data set just for simplicity, because I just wanted to have a data set. Doesn't really matter which one, because this is not going to be a good convolutional network. It's just like more of a proof of concept how the residual block works. So the data set really doesn't matter that much here. So here I'm implementing now this residual block, the one where the input has the same dimension as here the output from the residual part. So how does it look like? So So I implemented it using the Torch module class, just a regular confnet that I'm implementing here. I have a confnet with two residual blocks, and each of those is one residual block. So you can see that this convolution here represents this one. So here I'm starting with one channel, four output channels. Then I have batch norm. Then I have ReLU. By the way, I haven't really explained what that one means. I think I have used that before in some other code. So in place equals true. This just means that PyTorch doesn't have to make a copy of that array internally. So we could do something like, not here inside, but in general, we could do something like, like this. Just let's write it like this. So this will create a new tensor X and then overwrite this tensor X. So it's essentially overwriting this tensor X. But for a brief moment in time, when this gets executed, there are two arrays. If this is an existing one, so if I have some previous computation here, so this previous computation created X, and then when I'm calling this, it will take in X and create a new version while X is still in memory. So for a brief moment in time, I have two arrays in memory. It's not a big deal at all, but you have to, under the hood, allocate memory in the GPU and stuff like that. So it's kind of a little bit more expensive to do that compared to doing an in-place operation. An in-place operation is essentially modifying something in place without creating a new array. So it's slightly more efficient. It's not always possible to do that, but if you can do that, it's actually nice. So it's essentially the difference between, let's say, writing this and X plus equals one. In that sense, you are directly modifying something, whereas here you are having creating a copy and then assigning the copy to it. Anyways, it's a little tangent. The results are exactly the same whether you do this or this. And in practice, you probably won't notice any difference anyway. So it does not really matter. But why not doing it? All right, so small tangent. So we have convolution, batch norm, and then this ReLU. This part is really the first three. And then we have another convolution and a batch norm, which is this part. Notice that I'm going from 1 to 4 and then back from 4 to 1. Seems kind of weird, but why am I doing that? It's really like to match the dimensions. Otherwise, I will have more channels here than I have as an input. So I would have four channels here and then one input channel, and it doesn't really work if we add them, because then it's not an identity anymore. And we also have one fully connected layer. This is just to make this a classifier. So here's how I'm implementing this. So here I was just defining or initializing these layers the blocks, and here I'm calling them. So in the forward pass is really where things happen. So I save X as the shortcut here. So I'm saving this here. Then I'm calling my block. So this part I highlighted here, this is really calling this whole block, right? So it's this whole block. And actually I could have, these are kind of redundant, I could have used the same. Okay, but then of course the weights are different. Anyway, sorry. So I call my block here, and then I have my relu function. And the relu function is applied to X plus the shortcut. So this part really is this part. So I'm adding inside, and then I'm applying the relu. So the relu, that is what is shown here, and here I have this addition, right? So this is essentially one residual block, and then I'm repeating it. So why am I not using one here? Well, then it would be the same layer. It's that wouldn't work really. Okay. But the shape is the same. It's just we have different weights, right? So it's just like having two convolutional layers after each other. And then we have this linear here, which is turning this into a classifier. All right, so the linear layer has output the num classes, and here I'm just flattening it. So I'm assuming what comes out of this block 2 has a dimensionality 28 times 28 is 784. Yeah, and then I'm running this. So I'm just pasting my convenience functions that I usually have in my helper function. It's a slightly simpler version because I'm not plotting anything. I just want to show you that this actually runs. It doesn't get great performance because, of course, it's a very naive implementation. It's also only the training accuracy. The test accuracy is 92%. So what I show, what I mean is, how do I know that this is the actual number? I mean, I can think about it, I can look at this, but like I explained in the previous video, what I can also do is, I mean, what most people do is just print x.size, then you can, oops, let me run everything here. Then can run the training, and then you will see the size. Of course, you don't want to complete it because it's annoying to have it here, so I just stopped it. I can see, oh, it's 128 times 28, and that is what I can then copy and paste, and then go here and put it in here, right? So that's where this number comes from, and it is also where this number comes from. Okay, in practice, so if you don't want to think about it too hard and you are debugging things, I mean, it doesn't hurt to insert a print statement. That's what everyone is doing. Okay, so we trained that. Now, of course, I interrupted it, but suppose it trained. I mean, it trained before, so if I fix it, it would train. Now, the second part, now focusing on the more interesting part where we have this resizing here. So I'm implementing this a little bit differently now, using a reusable unit. I call that a residual block. So I'm implementing my residual block here, and this one is implemented the same way. Now it's a little bit more general. I have something called channels here. This is the input channels, or let's say the first number of channels, the output channels. And then here I have 1 and 2. So I'm going from 0 to 1 to 2. And I'm not defining what these numbers are. I'm defining them later when I'm calling this. So I can maybe briefly skip ahead. So I'm using this residual block actually in my convolutional network here. So I'm using it here. And here I'm defining the channels. I'm going from 1 to 4 to 8. So so that's what I'm doing here. So I'm going from 1 to 4 to 8. And then I have my shortcut, which goes also from 1 to 8. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to add it. Because if, let's say, this is one channel, out comes 8 channels, then this also has to be 8 channels. Otherwise, I can't add it. So that's what's going on there. So my residual block, scrolling up again, so we can see everything. So my residual block 1, 2, 3, this is really this part, these three first blocks, and then like before, these second blocks are this and this. Now the difference is, yeah, that I have different numbers of channels, and I can also reduce the size, right? So here I have a stride of 2, so that will reduce the size. I have to do a stride of 2 here too to match these dimensions. So here I have to be a little bit more careful that the dimensions match also. Yeah, and then as before, I have my block, I have a shortcut, and both the block plus shortcut, they go into my ReLU function. So this is what I'm showing you here. This residual block is really this whole thing here. Yeah, and then I'm using my residual block, I'm initializing one residual block and another. So I have a network with two residual blocks. The first one goes from 1 to 8, and the second one from 8 to 32. And yeah, the number or the size is here 7 times 7 times 32. So it's because we are also halving the dimensions here, half and half approximately. So going from 28 times 28 to 14 times 14, and from 14 times 14 to 7 times 7. Yeah, and this is essentially it. So that's how we implement this. So yeah, then we are training it, trains here, and yeah, it performs much better than our previous implementation. But again, the goal of residual networks is really to go deep in the network in terms of the number of layers. So here we only have 2 layers. So I mean, this is probably not a great network to use for other data sets. Here we are just using MNIST. So if we want to use a more, I would say, sophisticated data set, I'm actually only using Cypher 10 because it's simple to load. But if you want to use a different data set, ResNet 34 is a good choice. So this is the one, the deep one here. It performs pretty well. Going back here, it gets actually pretty good performance on ImageNet, top 1 accuracy, better than VGG, for example. And how does that work? So it's the same concept shown here, except more, I would say, more sophisticated implementation of that. So I could have implemented it by hand, but there's always the chance to make mistakes at some point. So why not using what's already implemented? So here, this is again, I'm using my helper functions. That's again the same that I explained for VGG16. So everything is the same as for VGG16, so I don't have to discuss everything again. The only new part here is really this part, the model. So here I actually copied the code from this website, which is an implementation, the official PyTorch implementation, which has different versions of ResNet. Wide ResNet, regular ResNet, 18 layers, 34 layers, 100 layers, 152 layers, and so forth. I grabbed the code that is used to initialize all of these networks. So they have written some code that can be reused for different types of residual networks. So here I was copying it and simplifying it a little bit. So it's not that long. And then they have something they call the bottleneck. It's kind of similar to what I call the residual block. That's what we have here. And then, I mean, it's relatively complicated, I have to admit. It would take me also a couple of hours to really understand how that is implemented. The most important thing is that it works. Many people are using it, so I'm kind of trusting that this is indeed working. So they have like a make layer method here, or function here, that creates these layers. It's a little bit more sophisticated than my version. So, and then in the forward method, you have these different layers. So each layer has also multiple convolutional layers. That's how you get the number 34. And oh yeah, we can also use the torch flatten function here. That's actually something I should also maybe use more often. It's a more recent thing, so I could actually technically replace that one by flatten. So here that could be replaced by flatten. But I still need to know this number anyways, because I have to put it here for the number of parameters. So even though we can put a torch flatten here, it's not that much simpler. That is essentially it. So here I would have to know still this number in this linear, the 512. So I could technically also write this as torch.view -1 512. I think blocks expansion here is 1. This is only used for the other types of networks, other residual nets. So could technically also write it like this. But yeah, we have this nicer flatten. I think what's nice about flatten is everyone knows what flatten, that it has a meaning that is more intuitive maybe than saying view minus 1 or something. Okay. Yeah, and here it's also the same code that I used for the VGG, and now it's training. Actually, we are using Cypher 10 here. Let me open this one again. So here I have 70 by 70 images. Scrolling up, sorry. Here I have made it larger because otherwise the performance was really poor. I mean, all these types of networks are really implemented for bigger data sets, not Cypher 10. I'm just using Cypher 10 because then we don't have to download a separate dataset if you want to reproduce these results. And I showed you how you can use your own dataset too, so in that way shouldn't be an issue for you. But if you have questions, you can always ask. I'm happy to help with that. So here with ResNet, we get approximately 48%, which is not much better than what we got with VGG 16 here. It's also kind of the same. But notice, even though I use larger images here, it was at least faster to run, 62 minutes versus 90 minutes. Okay, so if I would have made the images smaller here, the same size, it would have probably finished in like 30 or 40 minutes. Also overfitting, so here it might be a case for adding more dropout. So here we only have, do we have actually dropout? No, not really. We only have batch norm, so maybe could be added too, could be adding dropout. Okay, so some of the results gets bird and frog wrong. What was the one that this one got wrong? Deer and frog, interesting. So yeah, the animal classes are still confusing. You can also, you can see again the square where it makes misclassifications between different animals. Again, the cats and dogs. And yeah, this is ResNet implemented here. Honestly, if you implement networks, you don't have to implement things from scratch unless it's for educational purposes, like for learning things. Usually when you find a paper or read a paper with an interesting implementation or thing you want to try, usually what people do is they would go on GitHub and search for the original authors providing the code for that paper and then adopting this code. So you would technically not run it one-to-one. You have to probably make some modifications so that it works for your data set. But usually in practice, once we are working with these more complicated data sets, it doesn't make sense to implement this ResNet 34, let's say, completely from scratch. It's only another source of making errors. I mean, it's useful here as a thought exercise to do it with a simple case with two layers where you have implementation with two layers. Here it maybe makes sense to do that, but if you go deeper, ResNet 34, maybe use something that is, someone has implemented. It saves you lots of time and pain in that way. All right, so, okay, this is ResNet. I think we are already at the 75 minutes, so we will continue next week with the all convolutional network. I already implemented this somewhere here, and then we will also talk about transfer learning. I have to still implement it anyway. No, I have it here already. So we will talk about transfer learning also next week. All right.